EastEnder.
EastEnder.
EastEnder. That's an interesting t-shirt. From a West End Phoenix subscriber to an EastEnder.
I am an EastEnder. I've always been an, well, I haven't always been an EastEnder. But I
But
have
for the most part, you're an EastEnder. For the most
for
part.
aside from like 3.5 years where I was at like St. Clair and Dufferin, yeah.
Yeah. All right. Good t-shirt. Was that your Mother's Day gift to yourself? No? Okay.
My
Just
Mother's Day gift to myself was that beef tenderloin, shrimp, dauphin,
that you also got to eat.
and Brussels sprouts with bacon.
Nice. Good, wholesome, healthy dinner.
Yes.
Yeah, man.
It's good. How was your Mother's
Good.
Day?
It, yeah, it was fine. Had, there's this dish
That you had your lovely wife make for you?
no, there's this dish that, Ismailis, Indians, they love. And it is basically goat's hooves in a, I guess you would call it a curry, almost like a soupy curry. And you have it with like French bread, like you dip your French bread and you soak it up. You eat that and then you take the hooves and you suck it. I have never eaten it in my life. And I don't eat it, but that's what they had for breakfast. This is a breakfast dish. So that's what we had for breakfast. And then we went up to Main Street Unionville. And then we came back and had ribs. So yeah.
And your lovely wife made both on Mother's Day.
The first one was purchased the night
Okay.
before. And the second one was. Anyways, let's get to the show. Why don't we?
Let's get to the show.
Why don't we get to the pre-show?
Yes.
Listen, let's talk about songs. And not just any songs, but we're having Andy Kim on. And one of his hits, Rock Me Gently, has turned 50 years old. And like even to this day, you know, the song Rock Me Gently, Rock Me Slow, you know, it's just a, you know, it's just a fun pop song. What
An iconic
song?
song.
Yeah. Now, Greg, for you, what song is that for you? What song, like from you, like has always been in your ears since you can remember? Is there a song like that for you?
Is there one? Is there I can't like I'm like what was the war song? The band War. Why can't
Oh.
we be friends? Was that war?
I
Why
was
can't
thinking,
we be friends? Why
why
can't
can't
we
we be
be friends?
friends?
Why can't we be friends? Why can't we be
Do we
friends?
have to pay for the licensing when we sing a song?
Song by War.
Song by
I
War.
was right.
Yeah.
1975. I do. That's a song that sticks in my head from my
All
when I was
right.
little.
Okay.
Yeah.
What is it, you know, as a former touring musician, I don't know if you wrote any of the music or songs with the bands that you were, but what makes a pop hit stay? Like what is there certain ingredients or what is it?
I would say, I mean, it's got to have a hook.
Okay.
A melody that's easy to remember and easy to sing along to. And I don't want to say easy, I don't mean to downplay the importance of creating that hook, that melody.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm not a lyrics guy, so I can't tell you it's lyrics.
Yeah.
For me personally.
Okay. All right. Well,
What
why
is your
don't.
song?
Oh, I don't. I mean, there's so many songs from back in the day. There's Nat
You're
King
talking about like
Cole.
early 50? Oh, you are talking about. Okay, cool. You're going back
But I
all the way
mean, this
back.
is just like from my dad's, when my dad, Mona Lisa by Nat King Cole. There was another song. I don't know who sings it. Raindrops on my shoulder make me happy. Like
Kermit,
I've
the way you're singing
heard
it.
it, the way I'm singing it could be Kermit. But I don't know, like I remember my dad singing that to me back like when I was able to he was able to lift me up and carry me in his arms. But that's not that I've ever heard the song since or ever think of that songs, but when I think of songs from then, I can still remember them.
I think you're mixing up two different songs.
Am I? Raindrops keep falling on my head. That's one, but then there's
And
raindrops
are you
on
thinking
my.
of the John Denver Sunshine on My Shoulder?
How does it go?
Sunshine on my shoulder makes me happy.
Oh,
That's what you just sang.
then I am mixing up two songs.
Yes, you are.
I would not be a good witness to a
You
crime.
sent me in a different direction here because I was like,
Yeah.
unless you're
Raindrops
talking
keep.
about
Or
the,
maybe my dad was singing John Denver back then.
or maybe your dad was singing back then the 2018 song by
To the 2018 song.
ALKMTHM. It's probably a way to pronounce that that I'm not even going to try.
Listen, why don't we talk to Andy Kim and find out what makes a hit a hit? And let's find out about his timeless classic, Rock Me Gently.
Hello, I'm Andy Kim, and welcome to the music.
Welcome, 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 Andy. It is an absolute honor to have you on the show with us. We did briefly get a chance to talk to you at the Much Music Doc. Down at Roy Thompson Hall. Very, I know Cream had a few minutes with you. Want to congratulate you on 50 years of Rock Me Gently. One of the things that we, and I'd love to kick this off if you don't mind. I want to dive into your music and everything, but one of the things we were discussing on the pre-show is what makes an iconic song so good and so iconic? And we just discussed it. I'd love to get your views on that. In terms of what makes a song so special, before we dive into your body of work.
I have no idea.
Oh.
Well, because you know what? What makes a song special to someone else? Here's what I know. You're on the freeway or highway. Are you guys on a highway or a freeway? When you're driving, is it highway?
Highway. Highway,
Highway.
yeah.
All right. Yeah,
So
sure.
you're on a highway.
Yeah.
And one of you is going north and the other one is going south at the same time you intersect. And
Yeah.
at that moment, one of my songs comes on and one of you turn it up and the other one says, I can't stand this. So I think what makes a song iconic is not so much the artist, it's the response in your heart and in your being about something that you've heard. It doesn't have to be the lyric. It could be the guitar solo or a clavinet solo or anything. It's not a science. Your heart is where your heart is. Your instincts are where your instincts are. And if I may, since we have half an hour, I would like both of you to know that you are living your one and only life and no sequel. This is your one and only life. So you may as well be doing what you love to do with the person that you love. And for me, that lesson has really resonated inside my life. Because I am living my one and only life. And so I hope that you are too, and that you're not looking over your shoulder. I shoulda, woulda, coulda, if only I'da.
That's great. That's great.
Yeah.
Words of wisdom. So thank you.
It doesn't have to be words of wisdom. I'm
no, but it is.
You that bring that into your life when I'm gone.
Yeah, for sure. Andy, you started off your music career in Montreal, correct?
No.
Okay.
I grew up in the tenements of Montreal.
Okay.
But I went to New York City
to
find my dream. So I never played in Montreal. I mean, it's an odd description for someone who only knew two chords, had never performed in his life, but absolutely saw his future and believed in it so much that it manifested itself. I was allowed to be amongst the greatest. I'm just good. Those people were great.
What was it that, like, was it something you saw in others that you said, okay, that's what I want to do, and I'm going to go to New York to find it? Like, what happened? What was it that drove you to say, I want to be in music and I'm going to New York?
So I grew up in the tenements of Montreal. I'm the third of four brothers. My parents are immigrants from the mountains of Lebanon.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't know we were in the tenements. None of my friends knew we were in a tenement. We were just living this life.
Yeah.
And I came to understand later on in life that where I grew up, my destiny was also predicted.
Okay.
Because of how I grew up, where I grew up, that my destiny was predicted.
Mm-hmm.
Until I had the opportunity to borrow my older brother's transistor radio. And that transistor radio took me outside of Montreal to WKBW in Buffalo. Joey Reynolds was the disc jockey there. And WABC in New York, which had Scott Muni and Cousin Brucey. And if you don't know about Cousin Brucey, all you need to know is that there's a street called Cousin Brucey in Times Square. Okay. In the meantime, I heard music that kind of I didn't understand. They talked about the disc jockeys in New York, because WABC had a stronger signal than WKBW for me. They talked about the artists coming to the city, playing at Palisades Park, selling out or doing shows in a club somewhere, and the girls were all around them. You have to understand that to me, who grew up without a TV set, without the knowledge that a world around me existed.
Yeah.
I was blown away. That was my dream. And I kept listening to that radio station as many times as the frequency would come in. And it allowed me to dream the dream of dreams. And they talked about the Brill Building, and my brothers had a 45 turntable and music magazines. And I'd go through them and I'd realize, my God, this song was written by such and such from the Brill Building. This song was written by such and such in the Brill Building. So 1619 Broadway became my beacon, what I wanted to do and go. And I think you've heard the adage, ignorance is bliss. And if you hadn't, then that's me. So I chased a dream. My parents didn't understand what I was doing. My father came up to me and said, I never heard you sing. You just got a $10 guitar with a crack in it. I don't understand what you want to do. I explained it to him, but look, nobody understood what I wanted to do except me.
Yeah.
And I grew up to be me. I didn't grow up to be anyone else.
That's amazing. In fact, it's funny because I wanted to ask you next about your parents. I mean, I understand you're 16 years old. I can't even imagine either of any of my kids, you know, and my son loves music and was natural and the kind of kid that would just go, "Hey dad, I think I'm going to play drums." And I'm like, "Oh, okay." And next thing you know, he's playing Rage Against the Machine within 6 months, banging it out. So like, and I was a musician myself as well. Not on pure talent by any stretch, more on practice. But at 16, like how do you talk your parents into letting you go?
Well, here's the magic of it. What I didn't know growing up, because it was just, you know, I have two older brothers, and then there's like a 10-12 year gap, and then there's two younger brothers. What I finally found out in this dreamscape was that I had second cousins and cousins in New Jersey. But I'm a teenager, and these people already have kids, and some of them have grandkids. Because my dad was in his 50s when I was born. So he had a life that I don't know. He's my dad. What do I ask him, you know? Mm-hmm. It was my oldest brother, Joseph, who was kind of my father.
Okay.
And he was able to say, "No, you can't do that. You can't do this. Daddy would not let you do that." But it was difficult. But I needed to go. I couldn't explain to them. But I'd have run away anyway. So I ran away with their blessing. I met cousins that I didn't know I had, but I was able to get to New York City. I was able to get to 1619 Broadway. And look, I told you, I'm a lucky guy. I'm lucky that I am pretty simple-minded in the fact that this is my one and only life. I didn't understand it then, mm-hmm. but I was living it. I didn't care about what other people thought. I never thought there would be danger, but there was. I never thought there would be drugs, but there was. I never thought any of that stuff. All I knew is that I had seen my future, and I believed it so much that it made my family uncomfortable.
Hmm. That's interesting. When you get to 1619, what do you do? Do you just go up there and say,
well, it's very simple. The first song that I really, really loved was Be My Baby by the Ronettes. And that was written by Jeff Barry, Ellie Greenwich, and Phil Spector, produced by Phil Spector. And I saw a lot of the same names over and over and over again on the songs that I was connected to.
Yeah.
So in these magazines, it had 1619 Broadway. And so I got to the building and I went through the, you know, the register or whatever they call it on the wall.
Yeah.
And it said Lieber and Stoller's offices. And there was Jeff Barry, Ellie Greenwich. There was a whole bunch of other names. So I went. I had the opportunity to in 1860, a Canadian by the name of Basil King, Basil King, look him up. He is quoted as saying, "Be brave and mighty warriors will come to your aid." Be brave is me. the Mightier Warriors were Jeff Barry, the Brill Building, LA Greenwich, all the people that saw something in the beginning of a talent.
Yeah.
I didn't get signed or anything right away. It took a little while for me to go back and forth, and finally I get a note in my hand that said, "We're in the studio tomorrow, cutting How'd We Ever Get This Way."
Hmm. Wow.
Without any thought about, is it going to be a hit? Is there any? I was just living this life moment by moment. And I really, I think that whole world revolved around the people in the Brill Building. It was exciting. Sometimes, like in the afternoons, I'd sit on the sidewalk with my body leaning against the building, just watching people go by. From where I grew up to New York City is two different worlds.
Wow.
I don't know if I belong, but it was great for me to be brave enough. And I knew that Mighty Warriors will come to my aid. Only later on in life did I understand that quote. I had never heard it before.
Yeah. So tell me, what's happening in your life? What music are you listening to? What's happening around you that, I don't know, that something is planted in your brain that Rock Me Gently comes out? What's going on with you?
I moved from, you know, there was an exodus from New York City to Los Angeles. A lot of the songwriters were going, producers, you know, Carole King, Jerry Goffin, Barry Mann, Cynthia Weil, who wrote You've Lost 11th Feeling and so many great songs. And so was Jeff. Jeff Barry, who was my producer, was moving to Los Angeles and becoming part of A&M. So I made some money, and I thank God for my lucky stars that I wasn't one of those injured artists sleeping on the sidewalk.
Mm-hmm.
So I found myself in LA and I got a place to live. And it had been about a couple of years, maybe 3 years, since Sugar Sugar and Baby I Love You and a couple of other songs. You never know when inspiration comes. It just comes. Sometimes it's the sound of a horn, or the sound of just something going on in your head. And I picked up the guitar one early morning and started playing, and things started happening. It's almost like Sugar Sugar. So what do you write for a comic book character? What do you write for Betty and Veronica and Jughead and Reggie and Archie? Well, I don't know. You write Sugar Sugar. What does it mean? I don't know. That song didn't have any meaning, even though it sold maybe. I mean, Don Kirshner, before he passed on, said it was over 10 million, and I think it's close to 15 million records, or 12 or 13, whatever it was. It was Wilson Pickett's version that went top four in Billboard R&B, and he got a gold record for it, that people started to see me as a songwriter and not just the bubblegum artist. Wilson Pickett, Ike and Tina Turner did Sugar Sugar. Have you heard that version?
No, I don't think I have.
Have you heard Bob Marley's version?
Wow, no.
Okay, so.
Interesting.
So you go from one space to another based on who's recording it. But for me, Sugar Sugar was for comic book characters, TV characters.
Yeah.
Rock Me Gently was inspired by a sensuous moment in Malibu.
Okay.
The lyrics, and you come to a conclusion.
All right.
And I was young then. I probably wouldn't write that song today. Today, I'm a little more philosophical in my words, you know.
Yeah.
And it wasn't an easy path for you to get that song out with Rock Me Gently, was it? As I understand it.
Well, you know, I'll go back to you're only as good as your last 2 minutes and 30 seconds. And I think that mine had kind of run out a little bit. But I don't believe in... Look, you may want to cut this out. I don't believe in anything except how my heart and soul feels about it.
Sure.
I just don't go turning around saying, oh, well, they're doing this, I'm going to do this.
Mm-hmm.
It's not what I do. It's not how I, you know, conduct myself.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm basically mostly kind of a quiet guy. So I made the record. I'm the writer, the artist, the producer, the publisher. I thought I made the best record I have ever made. Just like, I couldn't believe it. I spent more money listening, keeping the engineer to late in the evening and just, oh, just play it one more time. I could not believe it was my record.
Hmm.
I could not believe it because it was just brilliant. So I finished my vocals. I did the little stuff that I needed to do. And the next step is to find a record company. Now, a lot of people knew my name.
Yeah.
But what they thought about me was something else, you know?
Hmm.
So I never had, it's like I went to meet Jeff Barry. I didn't go to be in the Brill Building going through every floor. I went to meet someone.
Yeah.
So I did the same thing with the record. I went to every specific record company I knew, every producer I knew, anyone who could help me. And at the end of months, no one was interested. And I would come home and I would put on the acetate that I had. And I would sit there and I would say, I can't believe no one's hearing what I'm hearing. So, and I've said this before, and I think someone wrote it in an article or something. I have never seen no as anything other than another opportunity for me to create my own destiny.
Hmm.
If some guy says no, I say, fine. I know I don't belong here. I'll go over there. And someone said, well, that's fine. I am never hurt by the word no, and I don't think about dissecting it because that's someone else's perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Am I talking too much, by the way?
No, this is perfect. No, it's always, it, yeah.
So basically, I thought to myself, okay, in the day, people had, you know, Phil Spector had his own record label. Jeff Barry had his own record label. I was on it, Steed Records. There were other people, but they're all iconic people that had their own record company. I figured, you know what? I'm going to start my own record company. I picked up the phone. I called home. My mom answered. I said, Ma, I'm coming home. Well, she started crying. She couldn't stop. But she didn't hear what I said. I said, I'm coming home. I'm going to start my own label. I'm going to be my own promotion man. I love this song. It's a hit. And I'm hoping that Canadian radio will play me. Because at that time, Canadian radio played me after my record came out in the U.S.,
uh-huh.
From How Do We Ever Get This Way and Shoot 'Em Up Baby and all those baby songs. but I really, really centered on wanting to make sure that I did a lot of promotion in the border states. Because
okay.
How Do We Ever Get This Way was first played in Detroit. So that was CKLW. That was somewhere that I needed to really kind of do whatever I can.
Mm-hmm.
And Seattle area was another area where they can hear a record that is being played on the Canadian side and ask about it. So I think it was maybe 2 weeks in, I'm not sure, I get a phone call from a stranger. And the stranger said, are you Andy Kim? I said, yeah. Said, you know, it's a hard time finding you. How come you're not everywhere? I said, well, you know, I really don't know. Even today in social media, it's, yeah. I don't go, you know, I have a, I think a Facebook page and Instagram or whatever. You know.
Yeah, yeah, fair enough.
I'm sorry.
No, that's good.
So anyway, so he said, look, I'm in Detroit and I'm a promotion man and I'm in from Los Angeles and everywhere I go, everybody's talking about Rock Me Gently. I mean, the mom and pop stores, those are the little stores that play, that sell records, to the major record dealers, to radio stations. I said, well, I just spoke to a trucker who will bring 5,000 units into the Detroit market to get something going in about a week or 10 days. He said, no, you don't understand what I'm saying. This is Wednesday. You need 20,000 units in Detroit by Monday. And I said, well, I don't know how to do that. He says, I know how to do this. Mm-hmm. And he said, take your master to Wally at mastering and just, he'll take care of it. And I said, do you want to sign me?
Yeah.
And he said, no. I don't want you to lose this record.
Oh.
I don't want you to lose this record. It's a huge record. It's going to be number one if it's done correctly. But I'm not interested in this conversation to talk to you about anything except get that thing to Wally and all of this stuff. So the following week, 20,000 units are in the Detroit market. And my record the following week after that is somewhere in the 80s with a bullet in Billboard, Cashbox, and all the other things.
Yeah.
And the Canadian radio stations that played me for 2 weeks and then dropped me, as soon as they saw I was on Billboard, they added me again. So I understood the way it plays, man. Yeah. I understood the way it plays. No one's doing you any favors. Who's playing it? How important is this song on our playlist? Oh, it's really hot in the U.S. We will add it. So I got it. But I knew when I worked in the Brill Building, all of this. I knew the way it worked. I knew there was payola, where they would pay radio people to play their song. Well, I got no record company except my record company.
Yeah.
I'm not paying anybody because I don't have that much money to pay them.
Yeah.
And it started to rise. And I will tell you this gentleman's name and a little bit about his history. His name, God rest his soul, is Al Khoury. And Al Khoury was president of the promotion department of Capitol Records in Los Angeles. Al Khoury, when the Beatles split up, because he did all their promotion, each Beatle had a writer in their contract saying, whatever record we put out, Al Khoury has to work it. When John Lennon went to Geffen, he had that in his contract. So, wow. And he eventually started working with Robert Stigwood, and he helped explode the Bee Gees at that time when they sold like 500 million thousand records that people burned in Chicago or whatever, you know. So that's who this gentleman was. And my freeze frame, if there's like a movie, and my freeze frame is, nobody wants it, I don't care, I'll put it out myself. A guardian angel shows up, says, you need to do this. I don't want you to lose this record. No, I don't want to sign you, but I eventually signed with him and that label. And the freeze frame is that Capitol is having a celebration for my winning, for being number one and getting my gold record. And I'm with the chairman of Capitol. I'm going to go to the UK to do Top of the Pops. He was going to come with me. The door opens and someone's unwrapping the gold record and holds it up. Andy Kim, great record. It was John Lennon.
Get out of town.
And I freeze.
Wow.
And I absolutely freeze. And the chairman takes me by the shoulders and kind of like, okay, we'll talk later. And John Lennon was there to promote Whatever Gets You Through Tonight with Elton John. And he was on Capitol, and so were the Beatles on Capitol Records, EMI Records. Do you know? Have you heard of EMI?
Yeah.
Yep.
Do you know what it stands for?
No.
Electronic and Musical Instruments. So when I went to do Top of the Pops, and we were selling truckloads of records, and I think I went to number two in the UK charts, it was the first time in 20 years that an American artist had a number one record and a number two record, or sold them that was records in the UK. So they invited me to one of their board meetings. So I went because I'm interested in life. I'm interested in people, how they're living their lives, how they're making their lives better, or how they're screwing it up. I'm just interested in people.
Yeah.
So I sit there. I'm there for 2 hours, and they never bring in the music world, because 95% of their money was EMI was done with everything else.
Ah. And
only 5% of their money was rock and roll, the Beatles, and whoever else was on EMI.
And Andy Kim.
But that was the day in the 70s, you know?
Yeah.
Wow.
So when I think about Rock Me Gently, I think the lesson is, if you believe with your heart and soul, and you do the work with your heart and soul, and you use your spirit to create what you believe in, even if everybody told you no,
mm-hmm.
John Lennon will show up. That's what I believe in.
That is crazy.
I hope I haven't bored you guys.
No.
Thank you for the stories.
Yeah, the stories and honestly, I know you said previously it's not words of wisdom, but even just that alone, I mean, that just, it gave me goosebumps to hear you say that. So thank you.
Yeah. You know, it allowed me to call Phil Spector and get his permission to come to the Lennon sessions in LA. And I'm a fan. I think when I look back and I listen to those songs, I'm a fan. And I didn't know that I could actually do it, but I saw it working. But it was an out-of-body experience.
Mm-hmm.
You know, most of the artists today, they've been playing since they were two. You know, granddad played the piano, and we've got a, you know, tuba at home, or we've got the flute. That didn't happen with me.
Uh-huh.
And it's kind of a strange story, even as I'm saying it, because it sounds almost like a fairy tale. But I love fairy tales, don't you?
Yeah.
And yeah.
Honestly, the stories you told, it is that. It's an amazing story. And I hope, and I know there's a mini doc with with Kevin and but again to do with that recording. But I'm hoping at some point there is a documentary of your life, because we all need to see that, and we need to hear it. And I'd love it if it came from you telling the story. So,
well, you know, Kevin and I are writing again, and we're doing stuff. I hope you guys know Kevin Drew.
Yep.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
So, I mean, Broken Social Team, man, to do that album with him was just another out of body experience. What the hell is Kevin Drew doing with Andy Kim? That's the bottom line. I ended up and he came with me to hold my hand. We did the Letterman show together. When Letterman was final weeks of Letterman, we flew to Los Angeles to do something with his friend Hal Wilner. And I'm on stage with Courtney Love singing Sugar Sugar. I could not have done this.
Wow.
I could not have done this.
Wow.
So you get Jeff Barry, you get John Lennon, you get Kevin Drew, you get people that help you and help you do stuff. And it's really lost on me how this happens. But I knew that God sent a special angel, because I believed so much.
Yeah.
And I always prayed. I pray in the morning and I pray at night. And there's only one prayer. Thank you, God, for this moment. In the morning and at night.
Well, Andy, I think that's a great way to end it off. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you. Thank you.
For
thank
sharing you. Some amazing stories, giving us insight into the recording, music, show business back in the day, and we wish you continued health and success, and hopefully we look forward to seeing you in Toronto over the holidays at your annual Christmas show.
Yeah, it's my 20th anniversary.
All right.
I hope you guys help me.
We will.
We've been there before. We'll be there again for sure.
Thank you. God bless you.
You as well. Take care.
You're living your one and only life. Look at that. And if you're not, then you better get at it. Remember, please.
Right on. Great message for all of us, for sure.
Yeah.
God bless you.